may have some Sharia issues that it is, you know, it will be not very exploitative. But I think the key thing is for this kind of meeting this kind of thing, you need to have different types of social institutions. And we need innovation for this. If you just want to, innovation is the key thing, and as you rightly mentioned, fintech is probably one of the ways in which this can be done.
Also, we cannot think that because the people are living among themselves, because Christian, Muslims, and Buddhists are living together. So we cannot point the one society, and we cannot.
No, it's strictly for humanity. No, Islamic finance is not only for Muslims. If there's something good in it, it should benefit everyone, right?
Yes.
And in Malaysia, some Islamic banks, most of the clients are non-Muslims because they see some benefit.
Thank you for your successful presentation. I have two questions. The first one is your country, for example, the South Islamic microfinance institutions are providing the recognition of Islamic microfinance institutions. And they charge, mostly they use Muraqaba, and they charge markup, which is very high. So some people argue that this is just a sort of exploitation of the poor. So what do you think, you know, the models which are really appropriate for the poor Christian society? And the second question is, I read Dr. Mohammed Yunus' book, and he argues that the interest charged by ground bank is not contrary to the Sharia, because the interest is reinvested, used to refinance, and it can be like used in the institution itself, so there's nothing wrong. Actually, he refers to some special scholars in Bangladesh, so there's nothing wrong with the interest in the loans.
Okay, the first part, you know, I think in Islamic finance there is legal requirement and there's ethical requirement, right? So the legal requirement is that the contract should be Sharia compliant. So if you're doing a murabaha properly, so you're fulfilling the legal requirement. But if you look at the legal requirement, forget the ethical requirement, you can use a murabaha to exploit people. Right? And this is the problem, that we don't talk about ethics too much in Islamic finance. So you can have quote unquote Sharia compliant contracts where you're exploiting people. And the key thing, and that's where the Maqasid and these things come in, that the key purpose of Islamic, I think, contracts is justice. And there has to be justice in contracts. And actually, that's why we have these contracts imposed on us. Because if you leave it to people, the powerful party in the contract will basically create conditions which are unjust to the poor. And that's happening in micro, you know, this credit markets, right? So the Islamic contracts are there to bring justice in the thing. But if you don't bring in ethics, you cannot achieve this. And unfortunately, in practice, and also, I think in academic literature, we talk a lot about these issues. As for the second one, I know his argument. His argument is, by the way, you know, the Grameen Bank, this is again a very interesting structure, that the Grameen Bank is part owned by the government because they provided the initial capital, but bulk of it is owned by the members. Okay, the shareholders are members. And in their board, by the way, they have people who take money, one of these women, they sit in the boards. So his argument is, this bank is owned by the members. So we are charging money from them. And there is a principle in Sharia that there's no interest on yourself or your family. So I think there is a principle, I'm not sure what is specific. So for example, I think it is within the family, I don't know if you can correct me, that there's no interest within personal. If I have funds, I take loan and I pay interest on it, it cannot become, I think, better place to family also. So what the argument is using is, because they are the owners and they are paying the interest, so in that sense it should be compliant. I mean, you can make that argument, but I think again there's some scholars who are. So it's going to be progressive finance, because this is another feature of government banks, which is interesting that the lenders, they won't actually bump up the government bank.
Yes. Thank you very much, Councillor
Keith. Thank you very much.
In this point, maybe cooperative banking can be Sharia compliant if this Sharia point of view is accepted, isn't it?
But I think we shouldn't go that simply so. That we are going to, I mean, yes, the bank rationalizes it, but I think it's better to come up with models which actually use Sharia compliant structures. I mean, I was trying to explain to him that this is Dr. Eunice's argument. Some Sharia scholars may support it, but it's better to know that. I think the key problem in Islamic finance is lack of innovation. What we are trying to do is just replicate innovation. Innovation requires resources in terms of time, thinking, and I think that somehow the Muslim mind is blocked in terms of coming up with this kind of ideas. There's a very interesting case study which I tell my students, and I think I've shared this because there are students here also. And you know, there's a girl, she graduated from UC Berkeley. She's an American immigrant from Sri Lanka, non-Muslim. So after she graduated in literature, English literature. So she worked with an fintech called Kiva.org. Kiva.org gives, it's very interesting, interest free loans. It's something like Kafua. Okay? She worked there for a year and then, And then she worked with another organization, Seed Fund, and this is again a social organization providing financing to the farmers in Africa. So while she was working there, she noticed, and this is the idea of, you know, the entrepreneurial mind. She noticed the problem of the farmers. And she saw that the farmers, when these are poor farmers in Africa, this was in Mali, Muslims. So when the harvest time comes, they have a lot of money because they sell the crops. And then they have to use this money for the next 9 months because it's once a year crop. Now, by the time the planting time comes, they don't have any cash. And what they do is, if they can get money from borrowing, only 7% of the farmers have access to borrowing, they get the money. Or if they don't have money, they don't have money to buy good quality seeds and fertilizers. So their output is affected because they cannot pay. So they are in a cycle of disorder because they are basically don't have enough money to buy seeds. So while she was working, she came up with this idea that, and she created an organization, MyAgro. If you can search, it's a very interesting thing. MyAgro. So she basically came up with the idea that, okay, when they have their crops harvested, they can save a little bit of their money. And because now we're talking about villages, the way she arranged the savings is that, okay, you buy this phone top-up, you know, this phone time, the mobile top-up. And in Africa, it's very common, you can use this cash to transfer, you can transfer cash. So you buy, go to a local shop, buy a telephone top-up card, worth maybe, actually, the average savings is only $10. So $1, $2 you buy, and you transfer this money to my neighbor's account through telephone. You can send a slip. And you do this because when the harvest time you have money, you just talk about $5-$10 of savings. So when the plantation time comes, my neighbor buys fertilizers, seeds, and gives it to the farmers. And because of this, the farmer's output has increased 50%. Now for me, this is an interesting story itself, but for me it is interesting because this is a solemn contract. I mean, it is a solemn contract, and we teach Islamic finance, these contracts. None of these 101 million Muslims came up with this idea that you can use a solemn contract. And the other thing is, it's not a financial institution. She didn't get license, it was very easy to open up this business. And now she has expanded to Senegal, and she's expanding to Tanzania using the same model. And I give you this example because I think it is this kind of innovation we need. She doesn't even know the model she is using is a sonic model in terms of contract. It's a sonic contract. If she knew, she would have. I think the approach to innovation is, we, as I said, we replicate in the commercial, we have a commercial product, make it a standard, based on the founders. But here she looked at a problem and tried to find a solution to the problem. And interestingly, the solution is Shigeru.
Some of the machine Sharuka models are used without knowing or without naming the, you know, in China or some Western countries.
I mean, there are other cases also in fintechs which are very like a keyword of robotics of Shigeru, and of course, they're giving interest to you. It's a similar to the Upwork model, but they have having deficits on So I think the innovation is very important. There are solutions to a lot of problems. If you can come out of the box and try to solve problems instead of replicating conventional structures.
Also, there is a news, probably you know. You referred to Islamic Bank Bangladesh Limited. That bank won the award of SIBAPI, Council of Islamic Banking and Finance Global Union. The subject of the award was innovative investment in micro, small and medium enterprises.
Maybe it was this program, I guess.
Yeah. The bank, Bangladeshi Bank, has innovative instruments to finance micro enterprises. I wish to make a comment on your presentation. Your topic was financial inclusion, isn't it? You covered the youth side of the financial inclusion. Also, there is fourth side of financial inclusion. We say that increasing the number of personal accounts. In this term, in Islamic perspective, the people having the Muslims having savings are not so high globally, but even those having savings are using conventional banks. Even in Malaysia, it is 20%. What is your opinion in this side to increase the awareness of Islamic finance to include Muslims to Islamic finance side from conventional side?
Well, I think the right way to answer this is there are among the Muslims there are three types of clients. One group, the first group is the religious client, who are very religious and they are not engaged with conventional because of religious beliefs. On the other hand, you have Muslims who don't care. They're secular, they're very comfortable with conventional. And in the middle, you have a group of Muslims who are pragmatic. They're okay with conventional, but if the Islamic is good, they will engage with Islamic. Now, I think in different societies, you have these three groups, proportion is different. In Saudi, the first group, it was estimated maybe 30-40%. Now, I was having a discussion with somebody just in Turkey, asking why in countries like Indonesia and Turkey, Islamic banking, as you rightly mentioned, has only 6%, I think, of the total banking assets that is stuck there. It's not increasing. So I said maybe one way to explain it is that with this first group in Turkey is probably 6-7%. So these people came and they have engaged with Islamic banking. To engage the second group, you have to have better services. Most of the Islamic products are more expensive than conventional. A lot of these pragmatic Muslims, they will say, okay, it's costly if you're buying a house, and if the rate of return is 2% in the long run, it becomes extremely high. And then this has been the case. I have students, like at some of teaching further, a student Muslim taking Islamic finance course, and he said, I want to buy a house, but when he took Islamic, it is, I have to pay 40,000 riyals more. So he said, I go for conventional. So this is in the middle road. So to get this client group, your services have to improve, your prices have to be low, and then you can actually cover the other. This is the nature of the market, right? And I think the same in Indonesia. They start at 6% because this first group, they have captured it. To capture the second group, you have to actually provide better services, price services. I think this is a market-driven kind of phenomenon.
By the way, the high cost of Islamic services or Islamic banks is partly explained by the regulation. I mean, it is the regulation of the country.